there anything I can do for you? What a ridiculous statement.
Mr. Grenion, I want you to help me.
I have a little sand left. What seems to be the trouble?
Some men are following me.
Really? I can't understand why.
She had a knowledge of what makes a man tick. I mean, things she learned from the ground up. And men could see that she knew and could play their game. And that's what attracted them to her, beside the fact that she was quite beautiful. Quite beautiful.
Well, there was something honeyed about her. Something fetching. Her smile and her conscious sexuality.
I'm Sugar Cane.
Hi.
Sugar Cane?
Yeah, I changed. I used to be Sugar Kowalczyk.
You Polish?
Yes. I come from this musical family. My mother is a piano teacher. My father was a conductor.
Where did he conduct?
On the Baltimore, Ohio.
Oh.
She was a gifted comedian, in my opinion. There's no question about that. She understood comedy. She had developed herself. Nobody gave her that peculiar, those marvelous mannerisms, the thin, high voice, the funny look, whatever was Marilyn, you know, that people imitate and never quite come up to. That was all her.
And the great success of Monroe, I think, was that she did not infuriate the female. By that I mean, if I told my wife after I worked or saw a picture with Monroe, let's say, she said, "My God, I'm crazy about her." She says she would understand it. But if I told her, "Boy, God, do I wish I could spend the night with Farrah Fawcett Major," she would hit me in the mouth.
Marilyn Monroe was born on June the 1st, 1926, in Los Angeles, and was registered as Norma Jean Mortensen. She was registered thus because Mortensen happened to be her mother's married name. But whether the father of the child was indeed Mortensen himself or another fellow entirely called C. Stanley Gifford is very much open to question. Not that it really matters much, because both men had vanished from the scene before Norma Jean put in her appearance. What is perhaps significant, though, is that the mystery and the doubt and the confusion that surrounded her entire life were already very much in evidence even before she was born. 36 years later, she was to die in circumstances just as mysterious and just as confusing. But in the brief period in between, she had been loved and lusted after, mocked and derided, abused and adored, and had somehow managed to establish herself not just as a sex object, but as the most marvellous symbol of sheer femininity in the history of the cinema.
The French are glad to die for love. They delight in fighting duels. But I prefer a man who lives and gives expensive jewels. A kiss of the hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend. A kiss may be grand, but it won't pay the rental on your humble flat, or help you at the automat. Men grow cold as girls grow old, and we all lose our charms in the end. But square cut or pear shape, these rocks don't lose their shape. Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
She was told she was the love goddess, you know, and she looked for love as anyone does who wants something simple out of life, and I believe she did. She didn't particularly care for money. She didn't particularly want to collect things, and I think she wanted to be married and have children.
Norma Jean grew up without a father and for much of the time without a mother, too. Her mother, Gladys Mortensen, worked, when she did work, as a negative cutter in film laboratories. But she was mentally ill and came from a family with a long history of mental illness. She suffered from paranoid schizophrenia and spent lengthy periods in various asylums and mental hospitals. So Norma Jean was shunted about from one foster home to another. And in 1935, when she was only nine, she was placed in the care of the Los Angeles Orphans Home, which stood here on this site in Hollywood. She stayed there for nearly 2 years and was finally rescued by a woman called Grace Goddard, a friend of her mother's, and perhaps the closest approximation to a mother of her own that Norma Jean ever had. And she lived with Grace Goddard and her husband until 1942, when she met James Doherty.
We did a lot of things together. Possibly people looking at her as the sex symbol of the world wouldn't believe that she could catch fish, skin a rabbit, shoot a rifle. She loved the outdoors. She would pick up anything, you know, except learning how to drive a car. She didn't do too well to start with.
Norma Jean married James Doherty on June the 18th, 1942. She was 16 and straight out of school, and he was 21, a good-looking young man, much sought after by the girls of the neighbourhood, and thus quite a catch for little Norma Jean. To some extent, the match was arranged by Grace Goddard, who thought marriage was the most convenient way to get Norma Jean settled down. In any event, Jim Doherty was willing enough, and he and his bride took a small house in Van Nuys, California. It has been alleged that Norma Jean had been raped at the age of 9 and that she had an illegitimate child at 15. Doherty, however, denies that.
I was first. And there's no way she could have had a child, and there's no way she could have been raped.
How did she look after you? I mean, was she a good housewife?
Oh, she was a beautiful housewife. She saw to it that everything was clean, that the meals were prepared on time, the clothes were ironed and pressed. She was very neat. She wanted a baby right from the beginning, but I felt she was too young, mostly to start raising children. I wanted to wait until, at least until the war was over. And she begged me to let her have a baby, but I said, no, not yet. Not yet. Wait till you get a little older.
Did you ever see any sign of the depressive side of Norma Jean's nature? Which came out much later, of course, much more obviously.
I recall she wanted to bring a cow in the house one time because it was raining, the cow was getting wet and was mooing. And I told her, I said, you can't do that. I said, that's crazy. And she felt very bad, you know, because I mentioned the word crazy, I guess, or I don't know, but I wouldn't let her have her way.
But that reference to crazy, that would worry her, would it, because of her mother and her grandmother?
Right. I watched it. Believe me, I... Norma, you know, I say, oh, man, that's crazy, you know. Well, you didn't do that around here. It struck a note of, well, she would become very pensive and worry.
When America entered the war, Doherty was sent overseas in the Merchant Marine, and Norma Jean went to work at the Radio Plane Company, and there she was seen and used as a model by an army photographer. From that moment, she was plunged unexpectedly into a whole new career. A Hollywood model agency signed her up, her pictures appeared in a large number of magazines, and gradually she developed the ambition to become an actress. But to do that, she felt she had to be free. So in 1946, Doherty, still overseas, received the Dear John letter, dreaded by all servicemen abroad, asking for a divorce.
Of course, she couldn't divorce me while I was overseas. I wouldn't sign the papers till I got back and talked to her. And then she told me that she was going to be an actress, and that they wouldn't even consider it unless she was divorced, because they didn't want her to be having babies once they spent the money, you know, to bring her from a starlet to a star. So, but she says, now, even though we're divorced, that doesn't keep us from being together. You can come and see me, take me out. There's no thanks. And that was it.
The divorce from Doherty became final in September 1946, and by then Norma Jean was 20, though she wasn't to remain Norma Jean for very much longer. She'd already been to see Ben Lyon, the head of casting at 20th Century Fox, and he'd been sufficiently impressed to offer her a contract at $75 a week. He'd also decided to change her name. Henceforth, she was to be Marilyn, after Marilyn Miller, the musical comedy star whom Lyon admired, and Monroe, because that was the maiden name of Norma Jean's mother. Now, in the more scurrilous books and articles that have been written about her, it's been suggested that at this time, Marilyn Monroe was busy working her way to the top on the casting couches of Hollywood. But when I spoke to him a few months before he died, Ben Lyon denied this most emphatically. Certainly, he said, producers would ring him up and say, that new blonde kid you've got, I may be able to offer her something. Send her up to my office at 6 o'clock. Well, both Lyon and Monroe knew that any proposition put to her in a producer's office at 6 o'clock in the evening would have very little to do with films. But Lyon still believed that she resisted all the advances, the temptations, and the threats. He remembered her as a very nice girl, a rather lonely girl who lived modestly and, on her small salary, quite often in debt at the Studio Club, a sort of YWCA for young actresses. And perhaps because she resisted the casting couch, success was slow to come to her at Fox. She appeared in two minuscule parts in very negligible films, and after a year, her contract was dropped. And so, in fact, it was at Columbia that she had her first significant role in a B picture called Ladies of the Chorus.
Anyone can see I care. The way I hold your hand and smile in your direction tells the world my heart is filled with nothing but affection.
Don't stop, go on.
Why don't you sing the rest?
Me?
Uh-huh.
I don't think I know all the words.
Well, then make up some of your own.
Well, some people could talk their way into her and get a lot of things from her just by giving them a sad story. And well, a lot of them did when we first started. She gave one a car for a while, her own car, 41 Pontiac, I remember it. I mean, that was back in the early days, you know, and Marilyn only was a stock kid. She didn't make that any money like that.
I'd say, well, Marilyn, why do you have to do this way? Because it costs a great deal of money. She said, don't worry, it's tax deductible. Everything was tax deductible, she thought. Had no idea about money, none.
There was a sort of a childishness about her that you felt that she should be protected from anything that could be disturbing to her.
In the early days, as a lonely and hard-up starlet, she found protectors, first in Joe Schenck, an executive producer at Fox, and then in an agent named Johnny Hyde. Both men were old enough to be her grandfather, but Hyde at least wanted to marry her. He proposed to her literally on his deathbed, saying that as his widow she could inherit his considerable fortune. But she refused him on the grounds that she was fond of him but didn't love him. Meanwhile, she was trying to become an actress and to educate herself. She was always carrying books around. Whether she read them or not is another matter, but she certainly carried them. Nevertheless, she was rapidly typecast as a dumb blonde, and it was as a dumb blonde that she appeared, thanks to Johnny Hyde's influence, in The Asphalt Jungle.
I'm sorry, Uncle Lot. I tried.
You did pretty well, considering.
What about my trip, Uncle Lon? It's still on.
Don't worry, baby. You'll have plenty of trips.
In 1950, Monroe was seen in six films, including All About Eve, and Hyde negotiated a seven-year contract for her with 20th Century Fox at $750 a week. But her career there was hardly helped by the fact that the head of the studio, Darrell F. Zanuck, had little regard for her acting ability and regarded her purely as a marketable commodity. Happily, though, the public liked her, and by the time she made Clash by Night in 1952, she was popular enough to ride out the effects of two sensational and potentially destructive revelations. First, that she had posed nude for a calendar 2 years earlier. What did you have on, Marilyn? The reporters asked her. The radio, she said innocently. The second revelation was that she was not, as Hollywood had been led to believe, an orphan, but that she did in fact have a mother, and her mother was once again in a mental home.
In California, there's a law that a child who has been abandoned before the age of 16 has no responsibility to their parents. But Marilyn never shirked the responsibility. When she was making $250 a week, she was paying for her mother's care.
Did she visit her mother much, though?
No, she didn't. But her reason for it was because it would be upsetting to her mother. Mrs. Ely's particular area of disturbance was on the subject of religion. And she felt that anyone who was in the entertainment business, you know, was just not all that you should be.
As early as 1950, Monroe, perhaps uniquely for a starlet, had been accompanied on set by her drama coach, Natasha Lites. The presence, influence, and interference of this guru reflected Marilyn's desire, much derided in Hollywood, to be a serious actress, but it made her most unpopular with directors. In 1952, another important influence entered her life, Joe DiMaggio, the great American baseball star who was later to become her second husband. But before that happened, she was finally to achieve stardom in her 18th film, Niagara, in which she played an unfaithful wife plotting to kill her husband.
Sure, I'm meeting somebody. Just anybody handy, as long as he's a man. How about the ticket seller himself? I could grab him on my way out, or one of the kids with a phonograph. Anybody suits me.
One of the most vital aspects of Monroe's personality, and perhaps of her popularity too, was her insecurity. Not a lack of belief in herself, but a lack of confidence in herself. Even at the peak of her success, there was an anxiety about her, a desire to please, that could be quite heartbreaking and evoked in both men and women a powerful urge to protect her. That insecurity stayed with her throughout her life, and in later years she tried to deaden it with drink and barbiturates. One of its manifestations was the fact that despite her status in Hollywood, her friends were not other stars and producers and executives, but people in rather humbler walks of life, hairdressers, publicity men, and theatrical gurus like Natasha Lyttes and Paula Strasberg. And another of its manifestations was her amazing inability to be anywhere on time. Now, the psychological explanations for chronic lateness are probably too numerous to list, but Monroe's own explanation is probably worth mentioning. Whenever she had an important date, she said, she used to lie for hours in a bath and quite forget about the time. The bath was a treat, not for Marilyn Monroe, but for Norma Jean, who, she said, as a child, had had to bath in water already used by other people. And the subsequent lateness was a form of punishment, a rebuke, again, not to the people who were waiting for Marilyn Monroe, but for all those people who had never waited for and never had time for and never paid attention to Norma Jean.
We would have like 300 extras, and she would show up in 2 in the afternoon. And I said, what happened? And she said, I lost my way. Now, she stayed at the same house. The studio was not moved overnight, and she'd lost her way.
Nobody could say, look, this is a professional commitment. You must do it. You go on whether you feel good or not. She could not do it until she herself was ready.
She just was frightened, inferiority complex. She'd be there in time and would say she'd play around. And the worst things was when she had to sing a song or something later on, which she could do nicely. She wasn't a great voice, but a nice voice. She would just pick up anything, the eyebrows wrong or something, you know, to redo it, or anything, not to just appear out there.
How do you put it around your neck?
You don't, lovey, it goes on your head.
You must think I was born yesterday.
Well, sometimes there's just no other possible explanation.
No, no, my dear, she's quite right. Like so. It's a tiara.
You do wear it on your head. I just love finding new places to wear diamonds.
Part of the myth of Marilyn is that she was the dumb blonde idea. And they were always a little surprised when I emphatically and truthfully said she was very bright. She was, really witty. And not in a well-read sense, but in her responses.
She developed a character. How much of that rubbed off on her, keeping that character, so that it became ingrained when she was off screen also, or how much of it truly was her that she just bent the part to, I don't know, but they did become intertwined. You couldn't tell where one left off and the other began.
Did you see this fellow I'm with?
I saw him.
What's he look like?
Very nice for a one-eyed man.
Is that all he's got?
What do you think he's got that patch on for?
I didn't know it was a patch. I thought somebody might have belted him.
Honestly, Paula, why can't you keep those cheaters on long enough to see who you're with anyway?
No, I'm not going to take a chance like that. You know what they say about girls who wear glasses?
Maybe somebody shot him in the eye.
He sounds just wonderful. I was naturally curious to know what he looked like.
Who is he?
I don't know that either, but he hasn't mentioned anything under $1 million yet.
In 1953, Photoplay magazine selected Monroe as the best newcomer of the year, thus proving that it takes many years to become a newcomer in Hollywood. But she turned up for the award in such a revealing dress that even Joan Crawford was moved to attack her in print for flaunting her sex. In a way, this underlined the contradiction in her character that Monroe was never really to resolve. On the one hand, there were the acting lessons, the drama coaches, the desire to be taken seriously. And on the other, her almost narcissistic pleasure in and display of her magnificent body.
I'm a semi-photographer, so I asked Marilyn, could I spend an afternoon with her on the beach? She said, yes, but I don't like a lot of people around me. I said, well, we'll find a deserted part of the beach. Fine. She wore a terry cloth robe. We got to that deserted part of the beach, and she took off the robe, and she had on a leopard skin bikini. And it was like, from out of all the corners of Fire Island, everyone came running to that section. And I say, that schizoid thing of saying, I want privacy, yet I'm going to wear this leopard bikini, is the split in her.
I remember when we were doing 7 Year Itch, and she came down the staircase, we were rehearsing, and she wore a nightgown, and it was kind of falling way out and falling straight down, you know, like the Niagara Falls. And I went up there and he says, Marilyn, are you wearing a brassiere? And she stared at me, you know, like I accused her of being a forger. A brassiere? And she picked up my hand and put it on top of those two marble edifices. And I apologized. Never again did I dare to ask, but there was pride, you know, the integrity of that thing. Christmas. Oh, the real McCoy. Two real McCoys.
When she left her hand and footprints here in the cement outside Grauman's, Monroe suggested to Jane Russell that, being who they were, perhaps they ought to leave the imprints of their breasts and buttocks as well. It was the kind of impish remark that was too easily misunderstood. How could she hope to be taken seriously, people said? How could she even talk about making a film of the brothers Karamazov, which was indeed her dream, when she flaunted herself like that? Well, of course she flaunted herself. She knew what a superb body she had. She took understandable pride and pleasure in it, and by transmitting her own pleasure, she gave pleasure to countless millions of cinema goers. But because she wore revealing dresses and no underwear, on the grounds that she liked to feel her clothes against her skin, she was dismissed as a dumb, breathless sexpot. And the fact that gentlemen prefer blondes, and most of the few subsequent films she made, revealed her to be an extremely gifted comedienne, passed almost unnoticed until she was dead, and it was too late.
She knew what she had been originally used for, which was the rear-end wiggler and the sex symbol and the big bosomed girl. But underneath it was it's like the comedian who says he wants to do Hamlet. I'm sure that Marilyn felt stifled and stymied by that caricature that she came to represent.
She did not have the disposition, the evenness, or the talents of some other actors. There's no question. But what she was doing was fighting and using more of what she had. It was more of a struggle for her.
She was just a perfectionist the way she wanted herself to be, acting-wise, singing-wise, or anything else. That's the only reason these coaches, and you know, got to her, and she worked with them so much, because she thought they could improve her so much. And if she could have just been her cute little self, she'd have been so much better.
In January 1954, nearly 2 years after they'd first met, Monroe and Joe DiMaggio were married. Apart from the fact that they were both national institutions, they would appear to have had little in common. He was a shy and reticent fellow, and she, well, she was Monroe. But he offered her love, and the part of her that was still Norma Jean was always in search of that. And he also offered her the security of a home and a family life.
I really feel that part of her attraction for Joe, I'm quite sure that she loved him, but it was the fact that he had a big family, because before they were married, why, every weekend Marilyn flew up to San Francisco to be with his family. And I think she liked the idea of being a part of a family.
He's the tops in his profession. He's all-American. She liked the all-American thing.
Korea, and a blonde bombshell hits the peninsula. Marilyn Monroe, the U.S. Army's favorite pin-up girl, takes time off from her honeymoon to entertain the troops. 10,000 gathered in this hillside theater. Trouble was, they all wanted front seats to hear her sing, and in the rush, some were trampled on. Surprised?
By the end of that honeymoon trip to Japan, where DiMaggio promoted baseball, and Korea, where Monroe waved her hips at the troops, the problems that were to cause the breakup of the marriage were already clear. DiMaggio was a home-loving man who liked to stay in at night and wanted a wife who would stay in with him. He disliked Monroe's sex symbol image, her career, and her friends. 8 months after the wedding, Monroe was beginning to drink too much and was going to a psychiatrist. And when she set off for New York to film The Seven-Year Itch, it was noticeable that DiMaggio did not go with her.
Well, you brought your hairdresser and your drama coach and four men from 20th Century Fox. All this for no joke.
Oh, do you feel the breeze from the subway? Isn't it delicious?
By the time this scene was shot, DiMaggio had joined Monroe in New York, and perhaps it would have been better if he hadn't. In 1954, a glimpse of a lady's knickers, be they never so chaste, was a rare sight, and DiMaggio was shocked and embarrassed.
I would have been upset too if I was standing on the sidelines and there are 10 or 20,000 people there watching the skirt of your wife's blowing over her head, you know. Also, she did wear panties, mind you. This, to begin with, take after take after take, and then you know, the New Yorkers, you know, various little comments being shouted from the sidelines, and many of those. So he didn't like it very much.
In September of 1954, 9 months after they married, Monroe and DiMaggio separated and were divorced the following year. Around the same time, dispirited by being offered yet another dumb blonde role, she also divorced herself from Fox. She left Hollywood and flew to New York, where, with an agent named Milton Green, she formed her own company, Marilyn Monroe Productions. And in her endless quest to improve herself as an actress, took private lessons from Lee Strasberg at the Actors Studio.
She would watch. She was a very observant attendee. Once she did a scene. Once. She did a scene from O'Neill's Anna Christie. And it was lovely, lovely to watch. Very vulnerable, very sensitive.
What effect do you think the Actors Studio had upon her? Did it do her a lot of good?
Well, not if you ask certain directors that she encountered who felt that it slowed her up, it made her impossible. But I'm amazed at her eagerness to learn and her desire to learn.
At the Actors Studio, Strasberg's wife Paula replaced Natasha Lyttes as Monroe's drama coach. And then, thanks to the huge success of Seven Year Itch, Monroe and her production company returned to Fox to make Bus Stop, in which she gave probably the best acting performance of her career. That was in 1956, when she was 30, and by now she was deeply and rather astonishingly involved with Arthur Miller, a serious and intellectual playwright.
She thoroughly admired him. She thought he was a great talent and a great writer. I think he used her. The way he announced her engagement was bizarre. He announced it to the press in Washington when he was up there for the House Un-American Affairs Committee, then telephoned her in New York and told her what he'd done.
Miller's announcement to the House Un-American Activities Committee, odd place though it was to announce one's engagement, did him no harm at all. Anyone about to marry the national sex object could not, it was argued, possibly be a commie.
I think he saw in her a vulnerable lady and he could protect her against all hostile forces, and she saw in him a father, a man with knowledge, a creative person, and that's what she wanted.
Would you like to appear in a play written by Mr. Miller?
I'd like to work up to that someday, if possible.
Is he writing anything for you yet?
No, not really. He's working on something, but no.
When are you planning to have some children?
Well, I'm not married yet, dear.
The couple married in June 1956 and almost immediately left for England, where Monroe was to film The Prince and the Showgirl with Laurence Olivier. It was an unhappy time for all concerned. Monroe was insecure and perennially late, Paula Strasberg constantly interfered on the set, and Olivier was irritated by both of them. By now, Monroe was taking uppers and downers as a matter of habit, and even her bridegroom was becoming a little disillusioned.
She was a difficult woman, you know. We like to always say the nicest things about her, and she deserves them. She was a very gallant person, but she was troubled and brought that whole baggage of her emotional difficulties of childhood with it. She was very insecure. She had psychiatrists in attendance, if not every day, a number of times a week.
One of the reasons for her emotional problems was that she desperately wanted a child. Soon after she and Miller returned to America, she did in fact become pregnant, but it was tubular and had to be aborted. This inability to have children caused her deep depression. It was as if she were simply some kind of sexual toy and not a complete woman.
The thing that she wanted most in the world was to be a mother, to have a child of her own.
Or she could have right away had some children, a child at least, because she loved children so much. My child, you know, my daughter, and other people's children, she went for them, or puppies or anything, you know. And she had one of her own to take care of, a doll of her own, you know, to grow up with, I'm sure would have helped her mentally.
For a year, Monroe was away from the cameras, recovering from her abortion and doggedly studying acting. Then in August 1958, she started filming Some Like It Hot. Her absence from the studios, and even perhaps her brave attempts to improve herself, made her even more uncertain than before.
Acting was not easy for her. She wasn't a happy type that just go on a one-take actress. Quite the contrary. She was filled with anxiety and apprehension.
I think that the help that she got from the director added just a little bit. The help she got from her studies with various acting groups, I think, only confused her. I think that she was born with something that is beyond directing.
Billy had given her every conceivable kind of direction, using obstacles, counterpoints, relating to your grandmother's raincoat, whatever. I have never heard such brilliant, marvelous, diversified direction given to one actor in my life. All of them legitimate, all of them within the realm of legitimate behavior of that character in that circumstance. Nothing worked. Still, it would be sorry, and the hands would go again, and we'd start again. About take 44, Billy finally said, when Marilyn said, sorry, again, he said, oy. Well, I tell you, Marilyn, possibly if you've to, and she said, just a moment, Billy, don't talk to me now. I'll forget how I want to play it. Well, I tell you, that did it. I blew the next two takes.
No matter how you suffered through those days and weeks and pulling those lines out like a dentist. They looked so absolutely and totally natural once you see them, and you loved on the screen, and that's the one that's thing that survived, you know.
I wanna be kissed by you, just you, nobody else but you. I wanna be kissed by you alone. I couldn't aspire to anything higher than to feel the desire to make you my own. I wanna be loved by you, just you, nobody else but you. I wanna be loved by you alone.
Some Like It Hot was financially Monroe's most successful picture. Professionally, she was at her peak, but her private life was once again in a mess. In November 1958, she had a miscarriage. Her addiction to the sleeping pills and the wake-up pills had led on more than one occasion to an overdose. And by the time she started to film Let's Make Love in February 1960, her marriage to Arthur Miller was under constant strain. And then, just to complicate her life even further, she had a celebrated love affair with her co-star, Yves Montand.
It was inevitable, I would have thought. I certainly thought it was inevitable. But it was Yves, unfortunately, who let the cat out of the bag. He let Hedda Hopper come see him, so he admitted that they were having an affair.
Amanda, I'm in love with you.
Now, Alex.
I've never seen this in my life. Amanda, I want to marry you.
Alex.
That affair with Montand more or less ended her marriage to Arthur Miller. He and DiMaggio had both seemed strange partners for her, but though in most ways the two men were very different, they were both highly moral and rather solemn. And they were both a good deal older than Monroe, more surrogate fathers, perhaps, than husbands. Neither man could accept that uneasy role for very long, and by June 1960, the only thing that kept Monroe and Arthur Miller together was The Misfits, a film he had written especially for her. The director was John Huston, who'd also directed her 10 years earlier in The Asphalt Jungle.
The girl that did The Asphalt Jungle was tremulous, young, aspiring, ambitious. The one that was in The Misfits was not tremulous, but trembling, an addict. She became dependent on drugs to go to sleep. I think she was afraid of not being herself in the next day, not being her most beautiful.
What was happening away from the film was infinitely more dramatic, because her marriage was just breaking up. He was in one suite, she was in another. They would get together. We'd have a press conference. There was a coldness and a hardness in their relationship. And yet, on the set, in the film, she had to be this lovely lady falling in love with this cowboy, Clark Gable. That turmoil in her, that was what I think was what was making her ill.
We had to stop the picture. She was a very sick girl.
Was she sick close to death?
No, sick like an addict is sick. They took her to a hospital in Los Angeles, and she was under care of a psychiatrist, and to get her off the drugs.
And what was she like when she came back?
She looked quite repaired, and it was only a few days before she was, I discovered, back into the drugs again.
In November 1960, with the filming of The Misfits complete, Monroe returned to New York and took an apartment here in Sutton Place, down by the East River. It was a bad time for her. The news of her separation from Miller was by now official, and she was hounded by the press, who were hoping to find traces of another man in her life. And in the midst of all this, she learned to her great distress that Clark Gable, whom she'd admired so deeply, was dead. So by the time she went to Nevada in January 1961 for her divorce from Arthur Miller, her nerves were already in a pretty bad state. And when she came back from there, she collapsed under the combined burden of emotional stress and far too many barbiturates. And nor was that the end of her problems, because for some bizarre reason, she was taken to a hospital for the mentally disordered, where, not at all surprisingly, her condition, far from improving, continued to decline. From this awful place, she was rescued by Joe DiMaggio, who took her to a much less frightening hospital. She stayed there for 3 weeks. And later that year, after she'd recuperated, she went back to California. Back in California, she tried again to reassemble her life. Not an easy task for a woman dependent both on drugs and the regular ministrations of a psychiatrist. She took on a housekeeper, Eunice Murray, and with the help of the ever-faithful DiMaggio, whose devotion to her was such that he has never remarried, she bought a house, the first she'd ever owned. And then in April 1962, she returned to Fox to make a film called Something's Got to Give. It was an ironic title because, finally, it was Monroe who gave.
Once she started and started working and getting wet and all that sort of thing, she some days couldn't show up. She was sick. And finally, they dropped her after about 5 or 6 weeks of off and on hit or miss situations of coming in. The studio dropped her, and they shut the picture down.
It was not only her illness, her lateness, and her non-arrival on set that caused Fox to fire her. On May the 18th, when she was allegedly ill, she flew to New York to sing Happy Birthday to President Jack Kennedy at a rally in Madison Square Garden. By this time, it was widely rumoured that she was having an affair with Kennedy's brother Bobby, the United States Attorney General, whom she'd met through Peter Lawford, the actor, and Kennedy's brother-in-law. And certainly Kennedy was in the habit of visiting her in California.
He came to the house one day, and I opened the door for him, and Marilyn was out in the garden. He went out there, and then he stayed about a half an hour or so and left. And she came to me immediately, and she said, "Isn't he nice?" He said, "Say thank you to the lovely lady who opened the door."
I felt that a man who was the father of 10 children with the 11th child in escrow didn't have any right to be fooling around. Now, I didn't know that he was, excepting for the fact that in going through Marilyn's possessions, I found a letter that his sister Jean Smith had written to Marilyn in response to a letter that Marilyn had written extending sympathy over the old man's stroke, in which Jean Smith said, "We understand that you and Bobby are an item, and we hope when you come back that he will come with, or we hope when he comes back that you will come with him."
Do you think she was very much in love with him?
I think that she appreciated having him as one of her admirers, but I don't know more than that.
However much of an item she and Bobby Kennedy may have been, the relationship was short-lived. Within 3 months of the Madison Square Garden concert, Marilyn Monroe was dead. With her career apparently in ruins, the last few weeks of her life were dominated more than ever by drugs and consultations with her psychiatrist. On the night of Saturday, August the 4th, 1962, 2 months after her 36th birthday, Monroe was found dead at her home. The events of the previous day have never been satisfactorily pieced together. Certainly her psychiatrist visited her, and it's been rumoured that Bobby Kennedy did too, and that she had dinner with him. But Mrs. Murray, who was with her all day and indeed discovered the body, denies this. Monroe was found with a telephone lying beside her on the bed, and there's a theory that, realising she had overdosed, she tried to phone for help. But why should she do that with Mrs. Murray there in the house? According to Mrs. Murray, she'd been quiet and subdued all day, and some people have seized upon this as an indication that she was depressed enough to kill herself.
I couldn't, as a layman, couldn't describe her as depressed. But I know she had many worries, and this particular day she was not lively and enthusiastic. She was very quiet.
Was she in the mood of a person who would later deliberately take her own life?
I doubt that very much. And she had told me that one of the very first things to warn me that if she takes sedation, which she did every night, sometimes she's apt to forget and would take a second dose too soon. And this is what she had to be very careful about. So that was the first thing that I was concerned about after she died, that probably had happened when she went to the telephone.
She was drinking some champagne, not a great deal, but she had several very mostly disturbing calls, one from Joe DiMaggio's son, and that disturbed her very much because she was very close to him, as she was to Arthur Miller's children. And he was in San Diego, the boy, and he was calling her, was very upset because his engagement had just been broken. So she was very very sympathetic to things like that, and so that would, she would want to go to sleep again to get over that, and she obviously would take some more Seconal.
Three separate theories have built up around the death of Marilyn Monroe. The first, which I think can be swiftly discounted, is that she was murdered, either in an attempt to implicate the Kennedy family in a scandal, or conversely, in an attempt to extricate them from a scandal. But either way, no evidence of and no plausible motive for murder has ever come to light. The second theory is that she deliberately killed herself, and indeed, the coroner's report attributed her death to probable suicide. But none of the people who were close to her at the end of her life will accept that, and neither will James Doherty, her first husband, who, it's worth remembering, was a member of the Los Angeles Police Department at the time of her death.
If Marilyn or Norma Jean had intended to commit suicide, she would have written a note to someone. She would have told them why. She loved to write letters, and she always put her inner thoughts down whenever she wrote. And if she was going to commit suicide, she would have left a note. I wish she didn't. So there's no doubt in my mind it was an accident. As far as murder's concerned, the finest police department in the world investigated it, and they come up with nothing. And that's enough for me.
But what about all the other things that somebody ripped out of the book, all the records of her phone calls? What is the truth of that?
All I know is what I heard. And I heard that she had made a phone call asking for help, and that the man who was the attorney general at the time was there where she called, which was Peter Lawford's. And instead of calling for help for her, they called her agent, and they couldn't get him, and I forget who else they called, but it was just rumor. It's nothing to substantiate any of it that I knew of.
Well, no doubt the need to build a mystery around a death that was already untimely and tragic enough stems from Monroe's relationship with Robert Kennedy. How close that relationship was, nobody now will ever know. But it was certainly close enough for him to have visited her at least once at her home, and it was close enough for him to get out of Southern California in a great hurry as soon as her death was announced. Now, that flight may not have been particularly noble, but nor was it necessarily sinister. On the contrary, it was probably the natural self-protective urge of an aspiring politician to put as much distance as possible between himself and the potential source of embarrassment and scandal.
Were you surprised at her early death?
Those violent desires have violent endings. It was a very special, special human being, and I knew that it's not going to be a simple third act curtain, you know. I mean, I just could not visualize Monroe in a rocking chair or in the motion picture relief home or married to somebody who is a pilot for United Airlines. I just could not quite visualize that.
Where would she have gone from there, given her mental, her psychological state was very low, and the fact that she was 36, that's not old, but I mean, she couldn't continue to play, you know, the girl with the figure forever. She knew it.
She was a primitive, a naive, an honest person, an idealist. And every time she'd run counter to what was evil or bad in a society, she'd suffer for it.
You know what I tried yesterday? I tried to sleep in the bathtub, just lying there up to my neck in cold water.
That sounds like a good idea.
But there was something wrong with the faucet. It kept dripping. It was keeping me awake. So you know what I did? I pushed my big toe up the faucet.
I guess that's what they call American know-how.
The only thing was, my toe got stuck and I couldn't get it back out again.
You couldn't?
No, but thank goodness there was a phone in the bathroom, so I was able to call the plumber.
You called the plumber?
Oh, sure, he was very nice. Even though it was Sunday, I explained the situation to him, and he rushed right over.
Did everything come out all right?
Oh, sure. But it was sort of embarrassing.
Yeah, I can see how it might have been.
Honestly, I almost died. There I was with a perfectly strange plumber. And no polish on my toenails.
Marilyn Monroe was buried here at Westwood Village Mortuary, just off Wilshire Boulevard, and every week, without fail, on the instructions of Joe DiMaggio, four red roses are placed upon her crypt. It has been said that Hollywood killed Marilyn Monroe, but that's too glib and too simple. Hollywood didn't kill her, it just failed totally to understand her, to understand the pain and the effort it took her to be what she was and to be as good as she was. In Hollywood, she was treated as something of a joke, a walking fantasy figure. It was okay to like her, but not to admire her. And what Hollywood quite overlooked, because such qualities are rare in the film business, is that there was about her an innocence and a sweetness that no other actress has ever shared.
During her association with Robert Kennedy, she asked an educated friend to draw up a list of topics that she might discuss with him and a list of questions that she might ask him. Hollywood would have pointed to this as evidence of her stupidity, but in fact it was evidence of her sensitivity. She admired the man greatly, she was quite possibly in love with him, and she simply didn't want to bore him. Now, how good she might have been as an actress, it's impossible to tell. If her talents sometimes seem limited, it's probably because the roles she was given were limited. Joshua Logan has described her as being as close to genius as any actress he'd ever known. Well, maybe that's pitching it a bit high, though Logan's opinion is at least to be respected. But what she certainly was, and what she proved herself to be time after time, was a most wondrously gifted comedienne. A woman whose combination of abundant physical charms, a positive cornucopia of femininity, and wistful shyness made you at once want to laugh at her and to yearn for her. Nobody since has come even remotely close to matching her. And beyond everything else, she was quintessentially American. She had all the warm and desirable qualities that myth and the movies teach us that all American blondes ought to have, but only she had them. Norman Mailer, I think, summed it up quite well when he said she was every man's love affair with America.
While tearing off a game of golf, I may make a play for the caddy. But when I do, I don't follow through. Sugar-dooga-doo, sugar-dooga-doo, ooh, daddy. If I invite a boy some night to cook up a fine enchilada, though Spanish rice is all very nice, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-da-da. Yes, my heart belongs to my daddy, so I simply couldn't be bad. Yes, my heart belongs to my daddy, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. So I want to warn you, laddie, though I know you're perfectly swell, that my heart belongs to my daddy, 'cause daddy, my daddy, my little old daddy, he treats it so. That little old man, he just treats it so good.
Had no handle on life, but by God, she had some other things, you know, that if we knew what they were, we could sell that patent to DuPont and they could manufacture it, because one would think that it's not that difficult. Maybe it's tough to make another garbo, but it should be easier. Blonde, small girl with a sweet face. My God, there should be thousands of them. They come from all over the world. Doesn't make him a hero.